Otherwise, thanks for asking. I want to get started because we have a great program. I'm going to try to get through these announcements briefly. We have some books over here and CDs of some Scottish music. If you'd like to check them out and take them home. Thank you for joining us here and at home. We're so happy to have a bigger crowd. More and more people are coming and joining virtually, so that's great. Our concert, Arts Live concert, is this Sunday. We have four hands, piano duet, Jim and Lee and Johan Kwan. They're very talented, and they are going to be performing classical selections that have to do with dance. If you haven't seen them before, they're dynamic. They're wonderful. Later this month, we have our book sale. Starts on November 17th, runs through the weekend. The friends do that. And so if you come and support the book sale and get some good deals, then the friends support us and do things like sponsor our concerts all year long. So it all works together and everybody has fun at all the events. And one more program I have, November 30th is Cuisine Quest. It's about foods from Central and South America. We will be getting recipes and restaurant recommendations, and I'll have more on that later because I'm going to get to our bagpiping tonight. We have with us Kevin Chapman, and he is not only going to be sharing with us the history of bagpipes and the different types of bagpipes, he is going to be performing. And as an extra treat, he has a video that he will be showing about his when he performed at the 75th anniversary of D-Day at Normandy. So I'm really eager to see that. I'm eager for the whole program. So please welcome Kevin Chapman.
Pardon me, I'm just going to quickly tune up. Is a little low, so I gotta pace myself here. I'd like to give you an overview of what I'm going to try to do, and I hope that's why you're here, is to get an overview of the bagpipes. What we're going to do is I'm going to give you my introduction, then move on to bagpipe anatomy, give you an idea of what is involved with a great Highland bagpipe. Now, one thing just to point out, everybody thinks that the pipes are from Scotland. Well, I got news for you. I'm going to tell you a little bit later. The pipes that I'm talking about are called the Great Highland Pipes. And there's an anatomy to it. People always ask me whenever I'm playing at an event, how do you play those things? And usually I say very carefully. Then I had the privilege, one of my instructors was a pipe major, which is the top rank in piping of the Scots Guards, plus he taught at the British Army's piping school. They actually have a piping school. and I'll explain more about that. And then we're going to get into a little bit about the various pipes around the world. There are more than one pipe that you should be aware of. And then regalia, what? I don't wear this every day, only at events. And then I had the privilege back in 2019, I was invited to play at the Normandy 75th anniversary. I played at Sword Beach. You are familiar with the history of Normandy. Sword is where the Brits and the French landed. There's Sword, Juno, Gold, Omaha, where the U.S., and Utah, where the U.S., and then the paratroops that landed, both Brits and the American, two divisions of the Americans. But it was quite an event. We played on a somewhat small ceremony that you'll see, hopefully, a little later, while everybody else was at Omaha. You couldn't get onto the beach at Omaha because Trump and Macron and all the leaders, the Queen, were there. And then I'd like to ask you to save your questions at the end because we have a matter of timing. The library closes at 8. So if you have a question, either write it down or try and memorize it, and I'll try and answer it. And if not, I'll make up an answer. How's that? Is that fair?
Yeah. Yep.
I know he's your brother-in-law, but it's just not working. I'm using this for a reason. I've had many instances when I've come to play, let's say, with an organist at a church or what have you. And I've actually been asked by the organist, can you tune to me? I go, no, you have to tune to me. Pipes are an unusual instrument. They have a 9-note octave. Do we have any musicians here or amateur musicians? 9-note octave, that sounds wrong, right? Why? Why?
Because you see,
octave is 8, right? But we play 9. We're different. So with this, it just shows that I haven't played with a mariachi band. I've played with other instruments, and that organists, a really good organist, will know how to chord to the pipes. And it, if you have the right organist, it sounds beautiful. Absolutely, if I'm in tune. But I haven't played with a mariachi band yet. However, I have been asked, I tell this story a couple times, but I have been asked for a funeral to play for this lady's husband. Can you play Splish Splash, I Was Taking a Bath? No. But how did I get going? Well, I started kind of late. I started out of college. My mother was a concert pianist, and I got tired of lugging a piano on my back. So when I came back, I had seen over, and my brother and I went over to Ireland to visit the relatives in Scotland, and I saw a couple of Highland games, and I really, because of the history behind the pipes, I really wanted to learn how to play. And I was fortunate, I found a couple of bands that I played over the years and some really good instructors. And then I was with the Shannon Rovers for a number of years, quite a few years actually. And what I wanted to point out was, let me get this going. A couple of the fellows, Tommy Ryan, Suitcase, Bernie McCudden, they were all from the old country, Ireland and Scotland. And they were kind enough to share their traditions. They weren't the best of pipers, but they could fool everybody else. Matter of fact, Tommy Ryan, if anybody knows Tommy Ryan, he, along with 5 other fellows, started the band back in 1926. He was a gun runner for the IRA, but we won't talk about that. And Barney McCudden, God rest his soul, all those guys have passed away, but they left a great tradition to help people like us really fall in love with playing the pipes. And then the other people are all out of jail now. And some of them are still playing, but most of them, God rest their souls, are passed away. Matter of fact, 2 of the fellows, that handsome guy right there and that guy, are alive, I think. but the rest have all passed on. So I was with them about almost 30 years. And then I played with a competition band, and I'll talk a little more about competition piping, which is more for the pipers and the drummers to improve themselves, not so much for the audience, although we usually draw a good crowd. But now I'm retired, and it's my retirement job. And believe me, I've been busy. So here's the anatomy of the Great Highland Bagpipe. Just to give you an idea of what I'm playing. The pipes over the years have evolved. I'll explain that, what I mean by that. But right here, if you notice the way I was tuning, that's the chanter. That's where the melody comes from. That's where the nine notes are. Now, one thing that's unique about pipes is that it's a continuous sound. You can't play it like a piano where you have a chord, then maybe another, you go into another octave and that type of thing. This is one octave, well, nine note octave. And the way we fool your ear is that, let's say you're playing 2C, the position on the pipes, if I can find my chanter here. Position on the pipes would be 2Cs, that would be a C. So what if I have to play 2Cs in a row? Do I stop the pipes and start up again? No. We use what we call grace notes, 16th notes, if you're familiar with the notes. So they're very quick, and they break up and make it sound like they're two distinct notes. And that's the trick to playing the pipes. Okay, so we're up here. All right, then with the bagpipes, of course, right here, the blowpipe. These pipes, you have to introduce air. The air goes into the blowpipe. It's blocked off by a little leather valve inside, and then the air goes into the bag. And the trick is to keep that bag fairly full so you get a constant, even sound. Very tricky. Then right here, these are what we call drones. Those, or sticks, as we say in the business, these are for the cording. That's where you hear that constant noise. This is one octave lower than the two tenors. This is a bass drum. These are two tenors. Then, of course, the bag. Now, the bag, that bag looks like this bag. This bag is what we call an M&M bag or an elk hide bag. It's actually made out of cow skin. These are out of date now. We're using synthetic bags like a Gore-Tex, et cetera. That's what I have, a Bannatyne. But just for show purposes, I wanted to show it. So they have to be cut and the drones have to be placed, and it takes a lot of work to get those going. You got to change them every couple of years, depending on how much you play. Inside, I don't know if you're back, if you can see it, but right here, there is a chanter. And if you're a musician, it looks somewhat like an oboe or a clarinet reed. It's a double reed, and it works on vibration. That's why never invite me to play a parade below 50 degrees, because the chanter or the reed doesn't work. Then on the drones, you also have a double drone that provides the noise. Air coming through provides the noise. These drones tune, that's what I was trying to do quickly, to the chanter to get it in sync. So those, the bass, the tenor, over the years, what's happened too, the real old pipes, going back to 16, 1700s, may have had one drone, then over the years they've added another drone, and it's mostly for tonal quality. How does it start? Well, most of your pipes nowadays are made with what they call African blackwood. It comes out of Uganda, Tanzania, Mozambique, comes out of German forests, and then it's sent to Scottish craftsmen. And that wood, whoops, I'm sorry, that wood right here, that picture doesn't do it justice, but that is really black. You can't put a nail
into that wood. It's that tough. But they, I'll show you how they make it. But that was sent to my instructor. He was a Scots Guard pipe major, and then he came over to Northwest Military Academy to help with their pipe band. They had a pipe band. Now he's at VMI doing their pipe band. But Brian brought that over with his machines. And believe it or not, it was held up in the Milwaukee Customs for, I think it was 3 months. Why? They didn't know what to do with it. Here is a cord of wood, and it's coming from, I believe it was sent from Scotland, not Tanzania. But what they do is they'll cut it up into parts. I'll show you that in a little bit. There's, it gives you a better idea of the size. Now, what he does is he starts cutting it down, he roughs it, and then he'll put it up into inventory until orders come in for the pipes. Here he's working on a practice channer. Practice channer is this. Practice channer looks something like, well, it used to look like this, but it's used for us to practice our tunes, memorize the tunes, work on the fingering and memorization. But he was making this for a friend of mine. She thought that by getting a brand new chanter, she would play better. It doesn't work that way. You got to practice. So that's roughed out. That's going to be a drone. That'll be put back into inventory. And then these are all pipes, portions, stocks that have been already made. But I thought it was an interesting picture for you because pipers like decorations. When they get a set of pipes, this might answer one question. How much does a set of pipes cost? Well, it varies. The pipes right here are probably, that's Hallmark silver. Okay, and these are probably being reconditioned because when you play a lot, and most pipers play a couple of times a day, you build up gunk in that. So he's reconditioning it. These are probably nickel plated just for decoration. And these more than likely are imitation ivory, as the Scots call it, which is a euphemism for plastic. So, and these are nickel here. And then these are roughed out drones, stocks. So he did reconditioning on pipes too. That's pretty big business. And he was working out of the school and he would make a set of pipes called Inveran. I don't own any stock in it or anything. He would make them when he was not judging or teaching or traveling to Scotland. There's some of his inventory. So he would pull, if he got an order, he would pull that up and put together eventually a set of pipes. There's some more different items. Those right there on the bottom there, those are chanters that are being finished. Chanters take a lot of work because they have to be exact. Because I'll talk about this a little later. Pipe bands, they have to be in tune. And the spacing on the chanters. Now this is an old chanter, but spacing on that has to be exact. So your low A versus your high A, which is back here, have to be in tune. So there's a method there, and that's where the real craftsman comes in. Brian was a real craftsman. He apprenticed before he went into the British Army with a gentleman called Jim Tweedy, who owned a pipe shop. And then eventually he brought all the equipment to Northwest Military. And I'm assuming he moved to the VMI when he took that position. I haven't talked to him. There's some more reconditioning and some other roughed out chanters, et cetera. And more of that give you a little better view. Now he's a craftsman. Some pipe manufacturers nowadays will do more automation when they're making the pipes. Brian does some machinery, but a lot hands-on. And here's an old way of doing it. Those are measurements for the practice or for the chanter to make it exact. So your low A, your high A, and the notes in between, those are the distance from low A to the particular hole for that chord. This I get a kick out of because Ryan was pipe sergeant, pipe major rather, in the British Army, and he taught the piping school. And here he's wearing an American uniform, Army uniform, but that was the military camp. But he was all excited about that machine because, believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, that's a modern machine. It was made in the 50s, but it's modern for piping because it exactly cut the holes for the chanter, which, you know, it may not sound much to you, but it's a big deal with pipers. And there he's hand finishing the practice chanter. You can see the wood shavings in the background, and he's got it on a lathe, and he's turning the chanter until he gets it down to where it's production. And there it is. That's the practice chanter. And there he's putting his trademark. And the lady behind him is the lady that thinks she's going to play better. Sue actually was a pretty good piper. Should I give her a lot of grief about that? Mm-hmm. Now, he makes a set that he inherited from Jim Tweedy, and they're called Inveran. And again, I don't own any stock or anything like that. But when I was at this school, one of the gentlemen ordered a set of pipes. He came down from Minnesota to attend the school, and Brian had the pipes ready. So what he's doing is tuning it, making sure it works accordingly. And the night before, I found out that this gentleman and a fellow that I knew from Dubuque, where I went to school, they started a new organization. They were both gynecologists. And so what they did was they formed a new association called the PGA, Pipers Gynecological Association. They had been overserved with adult beverages. So here's the big question. Does anybody know where the pipes come from? Don't be afraid. I don't bite.
Ireland
is one, yeah? No. No. Although they play them. So they, you'll get an argument. Anything regarding the British Isles, you'll always get arguments. They love arguments. If I say something here, they'll say something. But we think that they originated in Mesopotamia. And then like anything in our civilization, everything moved west. Okay, so eventually Rome had it. Then allegedly the Roman soldiers, when they conquered the England, just England, not Scotland, the Scots will remind you, even though they weren't Scots, they were Picts. They had pipes there, but it wasn't until, and this is another argument setting, one source that I read, the Irish actually introduced them to the pipes. Anybody want to argue? So Mesopotamia. Now, this part, I just want to get into, give you an idea of some of the different pipes, different types of pipes. You know, with the cornemuse, that's French for bagpipes. So that one, if you can see it here, right here. Two is Irish pipes. Irish pipes, that technically is not the correct term. It's actually Ilian pipes. Ilian in Gaelic is elbow, and I'll explain that a little bit later, what they mean by that. And then up here is musette. Here, Highland pipes. And then over here, although you can't see that much, this is an old woodcut, is what they call border pipes. Border pipes look something like this. This is actually a new form of practice bagpipes, but they're about the same size, and you could play them in this room and not get blown out of the room. They're usually used for ceilidhs. Anybody know what ceilidhs are? Dances. Gaelic for dances. So just give an example about pipes around the world. This gentleman is, I believe, in the Czechoslovakian area. Now, they don't look like Highland pipes, right? But here you have your bass drone. Here you have your chanter. Here you have your blowpipe and of course your bag. So he's introducing air and playing that. I've never heard those. Well, yes, I have. They had a group come to Arlington Heights one time and play that. Very interesting. I don't know what country these are from, but again, these are, air is introduced to the bag, and then these, pardon me, drone and chatter, and this is a bass drone. But one of the reasons I put that up there was because I saw this in my research. Pipers like decorations, and this with the silver is really a unique instrument. And I got this picture here, show you the detail on those set of pipes. So this is what they call right here a common stock. In other words, the drone and the chanter go in there, and this drone is separate. And again, I don't know what country that came from. These are a set of border pipes that I've mentioned before. So they're about the same size that I showed you my practice chanter. And again, they're pretty popular in Northumbrian or near the Scottish border, and they're used for dancing. And they're more in tune with quiet and not being blown. The pipes I play are really played outside, far, far away. I saw this picture and I thought I had to include it because it's a lot of fun. Anybody know what The Quiet Man, the movie?
Yes.
It's a classic, but you know what? Everything in that movie is a fairy tale. Nothing's real about that in Ireland. It's a fairy tale. But the gentleman who produced it right here, John Ford, he was of Irish descent and he had been wanting to make that movie for years. So we know that John Wayne, Maureen O'Hara, God rest their souls, were in that movie. It was filmed on the west coast of Ireland. So he had a cast party and he got a couple of the Republic pipers, Irish Republic, make sure you know it's Irish Republic. And it looks like they're having a pretty good time. This was an instructor that I had in Pittsburgh, and he is playing a set of pipes with he's playing it by the elbow. So it's introduced, the air is introduced with the elbow. So again, it's a dance tune. You can see right here is one of the drones, the bag right there, and then the bag underneath so that it keeps the air full, and then of course the chanter right here. Really a lot of fun. We were playing with some, I don't think this is derogatory, they were hillbillies, and they're clogging with those pipes, and it was a blast. This is your Ilion pipe. Ilion, again, I mentioned, is an Irish pipe, and it came about because back in the 1700s and 1800s, Britain tried to suppress the kilts and the pipes and anything nationalistic with Scotland or Ireland. And the Irish, being very clever people, you can't guess where my relatives are from, came up with the Ilion pipe. Now, what's unusual, anybody remember the chieftains?
Yeah.
All right, well, he played an Ilion pipe. And for a while there, I did all sorts of commercials and everything else used the music with the Ilion pipe. Matter of fact, the movie with Braveheart, now this is an expert talking. The pipes that were being played were not Highland pipes. They were Ilion pipes, but the producer liked that because it was easier to record. So the Ilion pipe, I don't think you'll get to see, unfortunately, get to see many. There aren't that many pipers that play that, but it's a very complicated instrument. Right here is the bellows. Right here is the main part of the pipes. And those, depending on the model, can play two or three octaves. It's really a versatile instrument. So he has to sit down. You can't move around like we can with the Highland pipes. And it's called Ilion pipe. Estonia has pipes. And then what's interesting, part of the reason for the pipes moving around the world, this is a small part of it, but in Ireland, years ago, back in the 1700s and 1800s, if you were the oldest son and the father died, you got the farm. If you were the second or daughter or what have you, you're out of luck. So what happens was a lot of this, the boys, the men that weren't the oldest went over to Europe because there was plenty of employment there with all the wars going on. And they offered themselves up as mercenaries. So this piper is actually documented in 1514. So they've been around for a while. But a lot of mercenaries were Irish. And here we have, I believe, Czechoslovakia, or what we knew as Czechoslovakia. And then even the Italians had pipes, Zambogonia. Now, one of the joys that I have sometimes, besides, well, I not joys of playing funerals, but I play weddings once in a while. Mm-hmm. And invariably, the mother of the bride or whoever wants me to come in and play a surprise. Mm-hmm. Well, it's a little tough to do. But I've noticed sometimes when I play at these banquet halls, I can barely get through the door. So can you imagine? Now, this is a woodcut, so it isn't real clear about the size of these pipes. But can you imagine trying to get that through the door? That is a Zambogonia. And the gentleman, the two gentlemen there playing, the lute and the Zambogonia, are brothers, and they make those pipes in Italy. And then the gentleman behind there is a collector. And so I'm glad I don't play those. We even have pipes in Africa, Zucra, that's Northern Africa, some characteristics of the bagpipe. And then this is a dual set. This was kind of interesting, at least it was to me. Your bellows right here, you could attach it to either one. And instead of blowing into the bag, you had the bellows to work that. So you could, I don't know, play cards or what have you. Even the Swedes have pipes. Now, there have been disasters in bagpipe making. This is an example. This particular set of pipes is called Brian Boru. Anybody know who Brian Boru was? He was the last great king of Ireland, and before the Brits took over. And so this gentleman who came up with this idea wanted to market it to the British Irish units. Remember, up until 1922, the units in the British Army that were Irish were part of the British Army. So he wanted to give them a more distinctive instrument rather than playing the Highland, the great Highland pipes. What you have is your drones coming out of a common stock, your blowpipe. And what's interesting is the chanter, what he tried to do was create a chanter that could change octaves. It was a complete disaster. He marketed to the units, they tried to play them, couldn't do it. So if you have a set of those, or you know somebody that does, grab them because they're worth a lot of money, even though you can't play. Then the history of piping, a quick overview. I mentioned the 17th and 18th century, when the Brits clamped down on anything nationalistic, what they considered nationalistic, the kilts, pipes, the instrument. Well, on the Isle of Skye, there was a family, McCrimmons, who actually saved piping. The Brits wouldn't go across to the island. And they saved the piping, they encouraged piping, they taught piping. They even developed a method that I can't do, but some of my older instructors could do, and that is teaching the notes, how to play the notes verbally. In other words, they would hum it, and the student would pick up on that as the note to play. Mm-hmm. Very, very intricate, because you couldn't write it down because the Brits would arrest them and possibly kill you. So the McCrimmons kept it, and they also came up with what we call pibroch. Pibroch is the classical art of piping. If you go to any of the Highland games, they have some contests there. where you can hear them play, and those are usually pretty advanced players. I tried it, I hated it, but it's usually it's a lament, and I'm being facetious, but somebody murdered somebody, or they lost a pet, or you know, somebody married the wrong guy or something like that, and it comes out in the music. It's not joyful. Now, the other thing I run into occasionally is in certain churches, the minister or pastor or priest associate the pipes with an instrument of war. Technically, that's not correct. But because when a lord or earl in Scotland wanted to get land in Scotland, the best way to do it was come to the king and say, look, I can raise a regiment if you give me the land and allow us to have pipers and wear our kilts, our clan, tartan. And so, yes, it technically was an instrument of war. This was in the museum in Scotland. And what it is a relic from the Boer War, which was 1899. And this piper in the Boer War got shot at, and the bullet grazed his drone, that indentation up here. Guns were getting better and better, and they should have learned from this, because what came after the Boer War was World War I. And I've got something on that. This is when I was over in Europe. We toured, besides Normandy, we went to northern France, where Verdun, the Battle of the Somme. And in the Somme, the Brits lost hundreds of thousands of men. It was fruitless. But even sadder was, I think the number that I've seen is as many as 2,000 pipers were killed. Because you think about it, the trench warfare, right? And they would go up on the trench, and the generals forgot that the rifles had gotten better. There was rifling. If you're familiar with firearms, in the guns, they develop rifling, which is a spiral type of indentation that creates the bullet, spins the bullet like a football, a spiral football, and it can go over a mile. Well, as soon as you come up over the trenches, because many times they're 100, 200 feet away, so the Brits lost over 2,000 pipers. What they did was they came up with an edict, and it said no more pipers on the front line. So they became stretcher bearers, they became runners, but they couldn't play up there on the front, because it takes years and years for a piper to be a good piper. So I was quite surprised when I saw this in the town of Ypres. It's spelled Y-P-R-E-S in Belgium. And every year they have a huge remembrance. I mean, it is, if you ever get a chance to go over there, it's amazing. About 6 o'clock, they'll have this remembrance under, looks like the Arc de Triomphe, but it has a listing of all the British and Commonwealth soldiers that were killed or never found. Matter of fact, while we were there, we were at breakfast at a B&B. There was a contingent from Northern Ireland. They were sent over there. They're still trying to identify World War I deaths, people that they couldn't find, maybe destroyed by an artillery shell, what have you. It's amazing how they suffer. I never know which restaurant reunions from Scotland. And that's my way of introducing the regalia. Kilts are not that old. That's one of the myths. That's why I developed the title. Kilts haven't been around, I mean, various forms, but what I'm wearing is called a modern kilt. Years ago, the kilt used to be, it would wrap around, and they would use it for a sleeping bag, because they were usually shepherds in that, to protect themselves from the cold. But I never had that problem. But to give you an idea of some of the regalia, that's called a Glengarry. That looks like this somewhat. This is my old Glengarry. It's kind of beat up. It's pretty common with some of the units, both military and civilian. Now, this happens to be in the Scots Guards and with the dicing. Now, I'll ask another question. This is called audience involvement. Anybody know where dicing is being used here?
What is dicing?
Checker, yeah.
It's the checker. Now, and don't say Ralston Purina.
Police in Chicago.
Exactly. Very good. Yeah, they actually adopted it from the Brits because at the time, I think it was O.W. Wilson that was a superintendent. They were having a lot of problems because there were a lot of security guys that looked exactly like policemen. So that's where they came up with the dicing. Most of the guys that you see in the dicing and short crafts don't play the pipes. So this happens to be a caubeen. Caubeen is more closely aligned with some of the Irish units. I tend to wear somewhat of a caubeen. Again, the Irish units, there's no more British line unit, Irish unit anymore. The last one was roughly 1985, I think, and that was the Royal Irish Rangers. So those are usually troops, although there were some Republic individuals, but they came from Northern Ireland. And there was a long line of other units that amalgamated, probably similar to what is going on with our military because of costs, et cetera. So that's a caubeen. And then a lot of units wear the balmoral, or beret, as we call it here in the States. Then some of the accoutrements that are worn, the dirk, usually a pipe major would wear that. And the dirk is nowadays more decoration. But years ago, it was a sword. So the sword is right here. Of course, the blade goes in here. But these are more decoration. That's a knife and or a fork and a spoon. So when they're out in the Highlands or something and they're eating whatever, that's what they would use. And then the skeindu. Skeindu is, I forgot to put mine on, but that's a small dagger that we usually wear in our hose on the right. How that came, and again, it's decoration, but be careful when you ask a question of a gentleman in a kilt, because he can get pretty nasty if he asks the wrong question. But that was used as a weapon because where else, they can't carry a gun, they're too busy playing, so it was down in their hose. And then the sporran. This is usually worn by bands that are trying to emulate a military band, what have you. It's strictly decoration. This is a sporran that I'm wearing. It's more of a dress sporran. That's usually horsehair. And to take that picture, I had to chase two horses to get that. Oops. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, no. I got my bagpipes in the oven. Easy to mix them up. This is an example of what I mentioned earlier, the Royal Irish Rangers. That was a unit from Northern Ireland, Ballymena to be exact. And that is, he's a pipe corporal. He's wearing the regalia that they wear. He's got a Highland pipes. And then right here, it's pretty common for Irish units to wear what they call a saffron kilt, solid color, or mustard-like color. Some bands use dark green, but most of the Republic and the bands from Northern Ireland wear that. This is an example. I wanted to include a full dress of the Scots Guards. They're playing in front of Buckingham Palace. If anybody's been to London, there's a beautiful ceremony in the morning, I think around 10, and the changing of the guard. And if you're lucky enough to see the Scots Guard, because it varies with the guard units, there's the Irish, the Scots, the Welsh. The Welsh don't play a pipes. The Irish do. And and the Coldstream and the Grenadier Guards. So this happened to be the Scots Guards. They're in full regalia, so they have their spats, which is, again, decoration, the hose, sporran, good set of pipes. The headwear is busby. Sometimes it's bearskin, which the guard units wear. That's busby. Those are terrible to play with, you know, when you're wearing them. I wore them for a short time. I couldn't take it. And this is an example of a pipe band while they're getting ready for the what they call the trooping of the color. It's similar to our American Army parading the color, passing in review. But you have the pipe major right here, and then his unit. Drummers we keep behind. We don't want people to see them. And then the unit getting ready, and there's the colors. So they, at the time, they would pass in review before Queen Elizabeth. And this is a full band. This is the Royal Air Force pipe band. And they're getting ready to go into the tattoo, if you're familiar, in Edinburgh, which is usually held in August. And it's St. Mary's Castle. It's up on the mountain, beautiful at night. And so they're getting ready to march in. It's quite a spectacle. And then I thought I'd include this. This was a unit that was in the British Army, but they were called the Irish Fusiliers. And this is right after World War II. And they are playing, if you notice, it's kind of a hard picture to see, but you see the two drones. The Irish tended, they're always being stubborn. They didn't want to play three drones, so they played up until I think the early 50s. But what they're doing is they're playing at what they call an officer's mess. And what that is officers come in their Prince Charlie jackets, have dinner, a couple of drinks, and then the pipers come in and start playing. And then the pipers are tested by a number of the individuals. They'll ask the pipers to play such and such a tune, and they're supposed to know that tune. And this is an example of the private sector. And I included this because I had the privilege of meeting their pipe major, Mr. Parks. Now, what they're doing is they just found out that they won the world championships for the 12th time. The only time that they didn't win was about 5 years ago when an Irish unit in Dublin won it, Lawrence O'Toole Pipe Band. But these guys, the Field Marshal Montgomery Pipe Band. The reason I want to include that is if you have a chance and you're interested in piping, this coming year in June, we have, Chicago has the biggest Highland Games in the U.S., the Chicago Games. And this year, it's going to be really, we think, really something. I'm going to be going to a meeting on Saturday. But they are opening it up to grade one bands. So grade one bands are the top bands. There are very few in the United States. I think there are maybe two or three. Canadian, they're all over the place. But these guys have been perennial type grade one. But in the grading system here in the States, there's grade five, which are usually the beginning bands, 4, 3, 2, and 1. But these guys won the world championships. They have, I think the attendance was over 50,000 people attended. It's immense. So is all that practice worth it? This particular gentleman, I think he feels yes. That was during a St. Patrick's Day event. And this gentleman is kind of a magnet. You know, they tend to be attracted to pipers. Okay, let me set the stage for this. I was invited, as I mentioned, to play at Normandy by some friends of mine that I met over the years with piping. And the event occurred on Sword Beach. As I mentioned, Sword is where the Brits and the French landed. And then they went in and their goal was to capture Caen and Bayeux. And they were protecting the left flank. So you have the Brits and the French here, Canadians in Juneau, gold, Omaha, and Utah. Omaha, of course, we're all familiar with that. And Utah, which is the other U.S., and then the paratroops landed behind to protect their flank. But this happened on Sword. We met at 6:30 in the morning, which is about the time that they landed because of tides. And it was quite an event. It wasn't as big as Omaha, where Trump and Macron and all the world leaders were celebrating the 75th. But these, some of the gentlemen, there are actually veterans there, and I was very privileged to meet a couple of them. So if I can get this started, let me do this. Oops. No. Can you, we're going to have sound on this.
Yep.
I hope.
Video.
Yeah. Yeah. We haven't practiced. Trying to get that started. Sorry about that. Well, this is not working, so I'm going to move on. Sorry about that. Let's go there. Yeah, well, I can move on.
Okay.
So what, I'll give you a narration of what happened. We're coming on, there are about 50 pipers and a bunch of drummers, and I'll show you pictures of some of these folks. This was the entire pipe corps, if you will, and what's interesting about it is they came from all over Europe. I was the only American, I think. And where I was right there. And so we were on the beach. That's actually where the British and the French landed. And then we countered, in other words, turned around and went off after playing. The gentlemen over here were French SAS, or our equivalent of SEALs. And we had been with them the night before and were forced to drink adult beverages. Man, those guys are in shape. But they came, and there was a French naval ship off on the, in the coast. But in that group, it's kind of interesting. You know, I think it's on the next. There's your essay, the French. They're pretty tough looking dudes. And that's the crowd. It drew a nice crowd. And then from there, if you've heard of some of the history, a lot of us, being American, we don't hear much about what our allies did during Normandy. But then we went to Pegasus Bridge. And if you're familiar with what happened there, it was a textbook operation of the gliders, troops of the British, landing about 100 feet from the bridge they had to take at night, and then being able to take it in 10 minutes. And the reason we were there on this beach was because of John Millen. John Millen was a piper under Lord Lovett, the commandos, and he landed. That handsome guy is playing, and the guy next to me right over here, he was from Ireland. And I think these ladies were from Belgium. There was even a couple of German pipers. Germans are fanatical about piping. But we're getting ready for the pipe major's command. And since I was the only American, I was assigned a bodyguard. Just kidding. That was a photo op. That's the gendarme, which is the French national police. She was pretty good looking. Probably said the same thing about me. Now, this is interesting. I happen to stumble on this, although it's fairly common now. But that is actually John Millen actually landing D-Day. And you can see they know that, one, because right here, what's that? Pipes. So what he did that is so remarkable is Lord Lovett said, you know, he said, John, I want you to bring your pipes and play. And he said, well, wait a minute, there's that edict about no pipers in combat. And Lord Lovett, who ran the commando unit, said, well, we're Scottish. That's an English law. So he went out there, and in the middle of the firing, and remember, these are Enfield, or actually the Germans used Mauser rifles, and they were shooting, but he did not even get a scratch. They asked him a couple of years later, how come? He said, well, I heard when they had a couple of prisoners that the Germans said, Dummkopf, he's nuts. Anybody playing the pipes and getting shot at, we're not going to touch him. He's nuts. But he eventually went inland with the rest of the troops, and he was wounded further on and then was sent to the rear back to England. But every year since World War II, he has gone across the channel, and the French have just paid homage. He died in 2010. That's the statue that they put up. And that's why we were there, to celebrate his playing. And his son was there. I met his son, quite a fella. He didn't know how to play the pipe until the year, I don't know if it was because of me, but he played one tune just for the crowd, and they loved it. There's a little better picture of him, but in the back is Sword Beach. I mean, it's that close, and that's where he was. And the Germans gave him the nickname Mad Piper. And this, I don't think, this is not working, but I played a Amazing Grace, which I will play now. Let me tell you the story about Amazing Grace. I'm sure everybody's heard that tune. The tune, when it went onto the pipes, was back in the 60s, and the Scots Dragoon Guards, recorded it, and actually Amazing Grace is an American tune. It's the lyrics were done by a Wesleyan minister who wrote the tune. He had been a cabin boy and was abhorred by the slave trade that they were involved with at the time, and wrote Amazing Grace. So it's a great tune. Playing for the 50th anniversary high school reunions, we lost about 10% of our class over the years, and I was playing a memorial for them. Mm-hmm. Oh, it does work. Well, we'll move on. Local treasure. That's the original social distancing. Remember Mike Myers with, we have a pipe out of down. So we're going to start the party. Bagpipers here. Are they cousins? That's for you to answer. And questions from the audience. It says, thank goodness I was getting sick of looking up. It's a no-kill shelter. So let's see, 7:30. Oh, good time. So now questions. Yes, ma'am.
When you're tuning it and you're doing something with the drone, are you making the drone longer and shorter, or what are you doing to change
the thing? Yes, to both questions. Depends on where it tunes to the chanter. I'm tuning to the chanter down below. So you're trying to get it in so it tunes, it's in harmony.
But you're twisting it.
Well, you do that to move it down, because on the pipes, I don't know if I can show you on my pipes, but on these practice pipes. All right, so I'm tuning like that, let's say. The hemp is there to keep it airtight and also to prevent it from slipping. That's what I'm doing. You turn it a certain way, one way, so that it doesn't overdo it. But that'll tune it, and you do, this only has two drones, obviously, but on the Highland pipes, there are three. Okay, other questions? Yes, sir.
So when you blow the air into the bag, of course, there goes the humidity, right? And there's probably some collection of water inside.
No, most of it's whiskey.
So I believe it operates on its own.
They tell me it's a disinfectant.
Okay, but if there is any whiskey, it's what, 40% of alcohol, so there must be something.
You're hell bent to find out, aren't you? Well, with the old bags, you had to air out the bag every once in a while because of the moisture. You know, right, I mean, right. There'd be times after a Highland game, you take out the chatter and you pour it, it would literally be like Niagara Falls.
So through the chatter.
Yeah, because of all your spit.
Of course.
But with the new bags, the Bantine bag, the synthetic bags, they have a water trap, and you can take that out and discard it and put in another one because moisture. Pipes are very sensitive. If you ever hire a piper for whatever, make sure it's not below 50 degrees because it's tough. Not only on the pipes, but on the fingers. Not the knees, but the fingers. And also because of moisture, if the reed gets real wet, it doesn't play true. And a reed, I forgot to show you that. I'm going to pass this around.
How does that work temperature-wise with like some of the cold Chicago parades? They always have pipers, and they're pretty cold from those days.
Well, they're usually overserved.
Yeah.
I did that for years. And one year, I'll tell you, I'll pass this around. What these are chatter reeds. And you can see it if you look. I've got it in the glass to protect it because reeds are very delicate. But in the cold weather, let's see, I played St. Patrick's, I think at least 20 times. But one year when Ted Kennedy came at the invitation of Jane Byrne, that's when we were going down Dearborn Street and the crowd, and it had snowed the night before. So just as we were going by the reviewing stand, the crowd got upset about something. I don't know what it was, but they started throwing snowballs at Ted Kennedy. And we thought it was kind of funny. So this is an example of a drone reed that goes in the drone. This is an example of the old drone reeds. These are cane. What else do I have? These you could be careful touching it, but I would, you know, if you want to look at it, those are more or less old. I'm going to try and recondition them. What I've also got up here is with the old bags. And as partial, I forgot to answer this to the gentleman. We had to treat the bags to make them airtight. This is the stuff. I don't want to open it because you'll probably fall over. It stinks that I have. But nowadays, we don't even have to use that. But you had to treat your bag every once in a while because of the temperature variance. Other questions?
So in the lower temperature, when it's below 50, the reed doesn't vibrate as easy, or your fingers are not operating right.
Yes to all your questions.
Because I've seen at last marathon, there was three people playing, two drummers and one piper. And it was really, I saw it was really tough. He couldn't keep the tune right.
Yeah, one year it was, well, last year I played a small parade up in Wilmette, a kid's parade, just a block long. And by the end of the parade, I could barely breathe because what the reed will not vibrate. It's just, you're blowing through it. So you're just blowing air. Yes, ma'am.
What do you call the part that you're blowing in?
What is all the part that I'm blowing in?
What's that part about? Because doesn't the bag fill the drones? So you only use one.
You mean when I blow up the pipes?
No. Oh, you just blow it up. That's all you do.
You want to try it?
You're just adding air and then the drones.
So remember that the air is going into the bag, and then it's going out the other escape way. You can't come back. It's going out the drones and the chamber. So here.
And what about the
Thank you.
That's where the melody is produced.
Okay, and then everything coming out is the drones, right?
Yep. For the most part, unless
and
there's a leak in
the
band.
How much do they cost?
A lot.
Thousands.
This particular set, I have two sets of pipes. This is what they call a presentation set. So this is Hallmark silver. This is ivory pre 76 before they came out with the band. It was already made. A friend of mine bought it. So it's a presentation set, but you don't want to know how much. More than bites. So it's a great tune. What's the what?
Why do you wear a kilt? Why a skirt?
Please don't call it a skirt. That's why I carry a skein do. I'm a churro lady. Well, let's put it this way. They were here before pants, before sewing methods got improved. And the Romans wore, well, they call them a tunic, but it could be a kilt also. What the Irish and the Scots did was they developed what they call a tartan. And please don't call it a plaid. It's a tartan. And kilts are not as common in Scotland as they used to be. Usually formal occasions or dress occasions and in Highland games. So that's, in a nutshell, that's how they came about. Your relatives probably, the males probably wore something like that. Here's, you know, over the years.
Well, I saw a man at an art fair wearing a kilt. I think he just wanted to be cool. The
library will be closing in 15 minutes. Please.
When you're blowing, how does that compare to like a trumpet player, or is it harder to blow through that
Harder than a trumpet?
Yeah, you know, like all those blowing instruments.
No, it is technique. I mean, with a trumpet, I used to play the bugle. You know, you got to develop a lip for that. Well, with the pipes, you got to develop a good diaphragm.
Because it comes from deeper.
Usually, but it's also technique. You got to know when to blow in to keep that bag. And what you're doing is pushing the elbow off the bag, technically. Questions? Yes, sir.
When Lord Lovelace's troops came to the Pegasus Bridge, he asked the piper to play a specific tune.
Blue Bonnets.
Okay.
And are you talking about the movie D-Day that you saw? Did you see the movie with John Wayne? And,
right.
That gentleman was actually, he played Nolan, and he was actually a pipe major. But supposedly, Nolan played Blue Bonnets a little more. But that's a common Scottish tune. Yes, ma'am.
I love the pipes, but particularly dirges. Are there any recordings with the pipe and drum dirges?
Well, first of all, describe what a dirge is.
For funeral.
Oh, slow marches. Yeah, I mean, I play it all the time. They're, depending on what the family wants, you know, most people, because they don't know any other pipe tunes, it's Amazing Grace. But if they're I had one, and not the Splish Splash, I was taking a bath, but I had one Off to the Stilly Night, which is a beautiful Irish tune. Flowers of the Forest, that was what was played at Queen Elizabeth. That's I do a fair amount of religious ceremonies with the pipes, and I'm privileged to play with some really good organists. The other thing that is... occasionally, not too many churches do this, but Christmas music,
but I'm looking
depending on the key.
I'm looking for a CD that has it.
Oh, they all have. They are, you know, you, let's see. If you got any of the Scots Guards, the old Lismore recordings, they'd have something like that, I'm sure. If not, I'll tell you what, I'll leave my card up here and you can contact me. And I'll look through my recordings.
Can you, if you wanted to, and if you got the right arrangement, could you technically play any song on the bagpipes?
That's why I started out presentation saying that the in that cartoon is you can't play every tune. What the Irish, a lot of the Irish tunes that people think are really Irish, they usually aren't. But they're transposed from other instruments. A lot of the Scottish tunes are actually written for the pipes. But there are a couple of good Irish tunes that have played on the pipes. But no, you can't play them.
Not even with a good arranger.
No, because many of them you have to change keys.
Okay.
Last one, I guess.
Yeah, how you came to be at the 75th anniversary? It seems like you guys are a pretty small group, like really good players. You guys all keep in touch.
Well, if you go online, World Bagpipers of the World, and a friend of mine reached out to me, and I didn't know about that, and it's brought together people in Europe. They go over to the battlefields like we go to the Civil War battlefields. Matter of fact, quick story, my dad was in the 82nd Airborne. And they used to wear jump uniforms. And on the beach, when I was at Normandy, I went out, I thought I saw a couple guys with the 82nd Airborne patch. I went up to them and I, hey, 82nd Airborne all the way. No say, como esta? Because in Europe, if you want to get a Jeep, go over to Europe. They've got Jeeps, deuce and a half, tanks, because the Army, when they left a ton of stuff. And they do the reenacting. I mean, if you go to any of the Normandy events, all up and down the beach there, it's all vehicles, camps. You know, sometimes they do reenactments here, but nothing compares to what they do over in Europe. So it was, in answer to your question, it was, yes, it was an honor, but it was also, they'd be happy if I had a blood flowing in my body and I could lift the pipes, but it was very interesting.
I think she had a question.
One last question from the young lady.
Oh. I didn't see you down there. I'm sorry, what?
The YouTube video you were trying to play.
Oh, you're gonna try, well, do we have time?
don't, how long is it?
It's 7 minutes.
Can we go on?
I tell you what, if you want. It worked a little today. You want to come up, honey?
She's going to do it for you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Danny Boy, I get a lot of people at funerals that want me to play Danny Boy. Danny Boy is an American tune written by an Englishman. England dominated Ireland.
You're from Boston, right?
Is Highland Wedding, Highland Cathedral, I'm sorry. Highland Cathedral, I play a lot of funerals and also weddings. It's a very majestic tune. And it's written by a German. So, thank you for coming. I'll leave my card out here. Thank you. Highland